Do we want to pretend like we're in school? Good morning, women in the Word. It's so great to see all of you. It's Tuesday, 9:30, and it's time for Women in the Word. And we say hello to Sharon and Agnes and all of our Zoom girlfriends. It's really wonderful to have you with us, too. So this morning, I have a brief announcement. Number one is we have a little bell. I don't know that I'll be ringing it in the morning when I come up, but I am going to have it at the back of the room because sometimes, you know, our noise level just gets a little louder and a little louder. So when you hear the bell go off, that means, oop, drop your voice just a little bit so the table next to you can hear what their table's saying. I know it's tough, but we're gonna give it a try. It'll just be a little reminder, and particularly if you're getting up and leaving and your three other girlfriends' tables are not quite leaving yet, then we need to get up and whisper so that we don't disturb the other tables that are maybe sharing prayer requests or actually praying. So thanks so much. The other thing I wanted to remind you about is our baskets. I know most of you have said you've already decided your theme. Great, that's fabulous. And there's still time to do that. Today would be a good day to do that. And then I want to remind you, and I will email this to all the discussion group facilitators, we're bringing all of our items to Women in the Word on October 25th. Write that down. You're going to bring all your goodies. There's going to be a bag on your table. You're going to put all of your items in the bag. And if you don't mind enumerating kind of what's in there, you know, where they're going to make a slideshow, and it would help the person, Miss Kathleen and her team, that is putting the baskets together to say there's this. And you might want to put a little approximate price or a value. Now, some things are just heirlooms and invaluable, but you can leave that blank, and I know Kathleen will know how to handle that. So drop that little list in the bag with all of your goodies, and that's October 25th. Hold up on bringing anything in until that day, and then we will collect them and get them made for the ladies' night out. Okay, I've asked Sharon Densford if she would come and pray this morning, and then we're going to go right into worship. Sharon.
Good morning, everyone. Let's pray. Dear Lord, it's so good to be in your presence this morning. We walk in the room and you are here. We're so grateful, Father. We're so humbled by the fact that you want to be present in our lives each and every day. That's an awareness that's almost impossible to grasp. But Lord, we believe it. We believe you are beside us in every situation. Some ladies today are here with heavy hearts. We pray, Lord, that you would lift them, give them joy, give them your presence. And there are those who are celebrating, and we're grateful for that, for whatever is on their lives, that you are allowing us those wonderful moments to celebrate and be happy. And Father, we pray for Kelli as she brings the word. We've learned so much already. We've been so blessed by studying Matthew. And we thank you that you have brought us all together, sisters together, in your precious name. And we glorify your name today. Amen.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. Though none go with me, still I will follow. Though none go with me, still I will follow, though none go with me, still I will follow. No turning back, no turning back. I just thought it would be a beautiful thing this morning to remember our commitment to following the way of Jesus. Our commitment to the one who is high and lifted up because of the love that he showed, because of the life that he lived, the life that couldn't be snuffed out. We gather in that name. The world behind me, the cross before me, the world behind me, the cross before me, the world behind me, the cross before me, no turning back, no turning back. No turning back, no turning back. What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arm. I have blessings, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, I'm leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. I'm leaning on the everlasting arm. Oh, how sweet to walk in this pilgrim's way, leaning on the everlasting arm. Oh, how bright the path grows from day to day, leaning on the everlasting arm. Leaning, I'm leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. I'm leaning, leaning on the everlasting arm.
I want to ask you this morning, what does it look like to lean on Jesus for you? And you don't have to answer that out loud. It's a picture that's always brought me solace, thinking about leaning in the arms of Jesus. And often I do it when I'm tired, when I'm sad. But what does it look like for you this morning to lean into the arms of Jesus? I can't imagine that Jesus wouldn't have a word for you. Maybe imagine what that word would be. Maybe it would just be a simple, I love you. Maybe it's as complex as, what do you want me to do for you? And maybe he just gathers you up in his arms and gives you a big hug because he knows you need it. I still think being loved is the hardest thing that we have to do. It's much easier to love than to be loved. Somehow being loved takes an act of confidence, vulnerability. You gotta stand upright in who you are. And I pray this morning as we stand upright in who we are, that we find in the arms of Jesus somebody that accepts us exactly as we are, loves us exactly as we are. Last verse. What have I to dread? What have I to fear? Leaning on the everlasting arm, I have blessed peace with my Lord so near. Leaning on the everlasting arms, I'm leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. I'm leaning on the everlasting arm. I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. Amen. Amen.
Thank you. Nowhere safer than those everlasting arms. Sorry, I have on different shoes, and I'm probably... My little granddaughter saw me this morning and said, Kiki, you look like a giraffe. A small one. So... You have now been to the zoo also today. Add that to you. I think the poor child used to seeing me in black because I'm trying to look skinnier or something. I don't know, but full on giraffe today. My internet broke. I've decided, I kept thinking, oh, we're doing this remodel right in the middle of when I'm trying to do other things, this being one of them, and I kept thinking, this is just not convenient. And then as I'm reading through Matthew, I'm realizing that C.S. Lewis was right when he said, we invite Jesus in to fix the leaks, and I'm not quoting, but the general gist of it. He comes in, and we think he's going to fix us up, and he gets to the leak right away, which is what we had, and you're so grateful and all those things, and pretty soon he starts knocking down walls and you're thinking, I was happy with it, just put it back the way it was. And Lewis says, unfortunately, where we'd settle for a cottage, God is building a palace for himself to dwell in. It's going to be uncomfortable and it's going to be full of surprises, and it's going to be fit to carry his spirit. So, maybe the remodel is my object lesson for Matthew. I want us to pray. I'm going to do something a little bit different this morning. I've asked a friend to come and share in a minute, but I want to sort of tell you where we're going to go this morning. And weren't you excited to only have two chapters? Don't get too comfortable. The walls get knocked out for the rest of the weeks. But these were powerful and beautiful chapters. Many scholars divide Matthew by the first 12 or 13 chapters into sort of one concentration on Jesus as the Messiah, and then the remainder of Matthew as sort of Matthew's understanding of what the church, what Jesus means for the church. So we're sort of in that transition after this week. But I want to pray and then tell you where we're going, and then ask Jenny to share a short testimony for us. Father, thank you that we can lean on your everlasting arms. Thank you for hymn writers who just are poets and pens in the hand of the Spirit. All the way here this morning, I was listening to your hymns, safe in the arms of Jesus. We can lean into them because we know we're safe. You've promised that we are. Thank you that you'll lead us like a shepherd. Thank you that your grace is amazing. Thank you that we can come just as we are. And so, Father, that's what we do this morning. This is your word. This is your building. This is your people. Lord, we would be fools not to see ourselves in the portraits that Matthew has painted of the way in which our expectations can exceed our commitment. And so, Lord, as we sang this morning, we together say to you, we have decided to follow you. And like the story that we'll read in just a few days, Lord, we believe and help, we pray, our unbelief. Where there is doubt, may we bring it to you. Where there is victory, may the glory go to you. Where there's hope, may its foundation be in you. And so, Lord, now I pray as we open this part of what Matthew wants to tell us this morning, that your Spirit will speak in power, that you will hide me, that you will hide Jenny, that you will, as we speak and share at our tables, hide each of our own stuff, that your Spirit might speak in power. There is no minute that your presence is not with us. But Lord, thank you for a place we can come where for a couple of hours we are immersed in it. We can't be distracted from it. And so, Lord, now we present ourselves to you. We stand under even that which we cannot understand fully, knowing that you are our Savior and coming King. And we ask all these things in Jesus' name, amen. So in these two chapters, Matthew has collected for us, let me back up a minute. Matthew has these five portions of teaching of Jesus, the way he arranged his testimony about the good news of Jesus. And in between them, he gives us other parts of the story. And every week when I start reading the commentaries, I think, oh, we should have just spent 6 weeks on this chapter because there's so much. And if any of you are interested or are going to be teaching Matthew, please reach out to me. I have a number of wonderful resources that go into far more depth than I'm able to. I'm just touching highlights of some of the things that the Lord used and is using in my life. But there's so much more. Matthew here wants to present Jesus now in his full ministry. Now Jesus has sent out disciples. In other words, the ministry is expanding. And to some, that's threatening, right? He equips the people and he has sent them out, if you remember last week. And then Jesus goes ahead himself teaching. Matthew, in these two chapters, collects a series of responses. And Matthew, what Matthew does not want us to do, that is our human default, is to say, John the Baptist is the good guy, Jesus is the king, and all those other people, they're just the bad guys. What Matthew wants us to see is the ways in which we live in a world where the kingdom has come, and we have to decide to whom we're going to listen and how we're going to deal with the very real world that is present in us and in among us. Matthew has so far taught us that Jesus is far more humble, far more faithful, far more aware of our need, far more concerned about our motivations, far more willing to forgive and heal than we imagined. Matthew has taught us that Jesus is more trusting of his power at work among his people, the sending out of his disciples, than we usually are. That Jesus is willing to reveal more about the Father than we were maybe prepared to hear. Jesus is more compassionate in our doubt, more confrontational in our determination to limit him to our understanding. And Jesus is more committed to relationships and to building a family of his own than we ever imagined. I don't know if any of you have been reading also in the Message, but Eugene Peterson takes Jesus' words at the end of chapter 11. Sorry, I should have it here. In my Common English Bible, where Jesus says, "Come to me, all you who are struggling hard and carrying heavy loads, and I will give you rest. Put on my yoke and learn from me. I'm gentle and humble, and you will find rest for yourselves. My yoke is easy to bear, and my burden is light." This is how Eugene Peterson, in his imaginative, common English language, hears Jesus speaking to him in this. "Are you tired and worn out? Are you burned out on religion? Come over here to me. Get away with me and you'll recover your life. I'll show you how to take a real rest. Walk with me and work with me and watch how I do it. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace. I won't lay anything heavy or ill-fitting on you. Keep company with me and you'll learn to live freely and lightly." But we will continue to live in this broken world for the time being. So what do we do with that? I don't know if any of you saw this. I'm going to try to pull it up on my phone. Actually, it's something to hear, not to see. Let me see if I can do this. Oh, that's not it. I'll do it later. Let me just tell you about it. A young man lived in an urban area, I'm not sure where, in America, and he's a composer. He obviously lived in a high-rise apartment building by the picture we can see of what he put up. And there was a car alarm just blaring all day long, just beneath his apartment window. And you can be sure that if he's like the rest of us, he had something he had to get written that day, right? While this blaring car alarm. And so eventually it dawns on him that he can use the car alarm as a sort of metronome. And he begins to compose. I'll find it and play it for you after Ginny. He begins to compose this incredible masterpiece of music with the car alarm as the backup, the bass. I have always said that jazz music is the most spiritual music because it has a very steady bass line, but you have no idea where it's going. You just know you want to be there to follow it. He wrote this incredible masterpiece, and several people commented that he should call it alarming. But it was spectacular. And when I saw that this week, I thought, that's exactly what Jesus is saying about the kingdom is here. Jesus didn't shut off the car alarm. The alarming facts of a fallen world are present. And to deny them or to try to hide from them is folly. But what Jesus is saying is the kingdom is here, and I can write something beautiful over that. And I will. We're going to talk today in a little bit after Ginny shares about when the rhythms of grace are hard to understand, like in John's case, how Jesus becomes our strengthener. When the rhythms of grace are hard to hear or hard to bear, if we'll bring them to Jesus, we'll find rest even in them, or great music playing over them. When the rhythms of grace meet strongholds of whether it's in this case demonic power, whether it's addiction, whether it's habits, whether it's bitterness, whether it's fear or worry, which are the addictions I tend to have to beat back, God is sovereign over them. The rhythms of grace play over the alarms of life. I think the challenge for us is to remember in the midst of it something that I'm sure that young man composing that piece would shake his head in an amen to. Often the rhythms of grace and the way in which God has redeemed our the events of our life can best be seen in hindsight. They're really hard to see in the moment. They feel like a series of unrelated, unfortunate events, to borrow from Lemony Snicket. And yet, in hindsight, we see. And I think that God gave us this beautiful... Oh, sorry. Oh, you have it. You are so kind. Thank you. Somebody actually pulled it up for me. Y'all are just brilliant. Thank you. But I'll just finish this thought. I think that God showed this to Moses in the very beginning. I'm convinced that pretty much the entire gospel is in the Exodus story. But certainly this. Do you remember Moses says to God, just let me see you. It's sort of give me a sign, but it's give me a sign knowing it's a faithful give me a sign. And God says, well, you know, Moses, I can't exactly do that. But in Exodus 33, beginning with verse 21, the Lord says, there is a place near me where you can come and stand on a rock. And when my glory passes by, I will put a cleft in that rock and I'll cover you with my hand. Those everlasting arms, until I've passed by. And then I'll remove my hand, and you'll see my back, but you won't see my face. It's almost like God saying, you know, in our humanness, it's going to be most often that we're going to see the glory of God in hindsight, the back of it, after it's happened. All right, you want to hear this incredible thing? All right, are you ready for this person? Let's see if I can bless you for finding this. Maybe it's going to load. Ginny, come on up, because I might be slow here. Okay, you come up, and if you get here before this starts, we'll do it after. I'm such a tech genius here. Just embarrassing. She even has it ready for me and I can't make it play. Ginny, come on. We'll do this right after. Do you mind if I leave this here? Okay, thank you.
Thank you. I'm beginning to realize that much of my life I'm having to learn from the back side. But she asked me to speak and give a testimony, and I thought, I've gone through so much in life, I'm not sure where to start, but I'm going to tell you of a time where I really misbehaved and when you still loved me and saw God come through in a powerful way. I'm married in 1958. That's significant in the story. I was also struggled from 1958 until 1990 with the fact that I had been raised a portion of my life in an occultic commune, and I didn't want anyone to know that. I didn't want my husband to know it. I didn't want my church to know it, because I felt if you knew it, you wouldn't love me anymore. And I had such a need for love, as we all do. The other thing that I want to say here, that another part of this in my thinking was that I was one that was determined. I remember as a little girl watching the satanic things, and at 4 years old, putting my hands on my hips and saying, Satan, I am never going to serve you. And believe me, I was tried on that at times. And I want to share a time that the trial came. In 1980s, late 80s, my life was perfect. I had 5 children, which I just absolutely adored. I had grandchildren. We all lived in the same town. My husband and I were on staff at a church that just was dynamic, and we wouldn't have traded being in any other church. And I had managed for years at OBGYN clinic and loved my work there. My life was perfect. This was in Ontario, California. And my husband worked for a company, decided that they were going to get rid of all employees that were within 3 years of retirement, so they wouldn't have to pay retirement. So at age 58, my husband lost his job. And we still had 5 children living at home, plus 2 grandchildren living with us. So it was not an easy time. One day my husband came in. I wish you could have known him, because he had such a gentle nature about him. He came in and he says, sweetheart, I need to sit down with you for a minute. We need to talk about something. And I thought, oh boy, wonder where this is going. And he says, I think I have a job. I said, you do? That's wonderful. And he goes, it's in Florence, Oregon. Has anybody in this room been to Florence, Oregon? Mm-hmm. Beautiful place. Had 15,000 people at that time. I don't know what the population is now. Now, go back to what I just said. I have everything I want in life going for me. The other thing, I was president of a women's club chapter of about 350 women in Rancho Cucamonga, and loved it. That was another part of my life I didn't want to give up. And my husband has got this smile on his face, full of thanksgiving, that we're going to move to Florence, Oregon. Well, I want to tell you, girls, my husband was career military, and we moved a lot. We moved all over the world. And I loved moving. I loved to experience new people. I loved to experience new countries. I loved to experience new settings. And this is the first time, when we married in 1958, that I strongly put my hands on my hips in my brain, not to him in person, and say, you may be going to Florence, but I'm not going. So my husband went to Florence. I stayed home, and he was supposed to be home on a Friday. Thanksgiving was Thursday, and I had a plan. I wasn't going to Florence. I bought my bus ticket. I packed my bags. I got the cab to take me to the bus station. I had it all worked out. And I'm headed out the door to get in the cab to go to the bus station to get to the airport. And my husband drove up just as the taxi cab got there. He looked at my suitcase. He looked at me. And he very gently picked up the suitcase and took it in the house and put it all away. And inside of me, I'm going, I'm still not going. There was something, I did not want to leave what I had. Well, precious people, I did go. And it was one of the hardest moves I've ever made in my life. You have to understand another part of this is that I have a beautiful black adopted son, which is part of the story I'm going to tell you before that's coming up now. And we went to Florence, and we no more than got there, and my husband at age 61 was activated into Desert Storm. We got a call at 4 o'clock, and he was to be at Portland Airport at 11 p.m. We had no idea where he was going. In fact, even the captain tells us it's in this envelope, and this envelope will not be opened up until we're 30,000 feet in the air. I do not know where we're going. We just moved. Our furniture wasn't there yet. I didn't know anybody. I hadn't got Joseph in school. We just barely got there. And I thought, this is crazy. This is just absolutely crazy. And then on top of it all, the Ku Klux Klan came and visited me 3 times. And it wasn't fun. And all this story, please remember the scripture that Kelli just read us. There are rhythms of grace. I saw 0 grace in this story because I was so involved with me. I saw, did not see God in it at all. We had dreamed since 1960 of someday going to Japan as missionaries, and we hadn't done that, and we're into 1990. And so we're in this little bitty town, in this little bitty church, that if we had 8 on Wednesday night, we were thrilled. And if we had 20 on Sunday, it was really a thrill. And you expected, I expected, I put it that way, I expected nothing good to come out of it. Nothing. And we didn't talk, I didn't talk about, you know, my husband's in the military. He was top secret. I didn't know where he was, so I couldn't tell anybody else where he was. All I could say, he was in the military. And oh my goodness, I went there months. My husband was in for almost 2 years. And I went all that time, and people didn't know much about me at that point. I was too devastated by life. I didn't want to talk about it. And one night, my husband had come home on leave because he had to go to a military base somewhere else, and he was in transit, and that gave him a chance to come by home. And lo and behold, we walked in church on Wednesday night, and here came Sister Betty Basil. I will never forget her. And she had a letter in her hand. And she says, this letter came today, and it was the Holy Spirit. This is for the Reeses. And it was a letter looking for someone to come and take over a move that they wanted to take place in Japan of setting up what they call Christian servicemen's homes by each one of the bases. And they were asking us to go and take over that ministry. Nobody knew our secret but God. Nobody knew that's what we dreamed of since 1960. No one knew except God that I hadn't told my husband of my upbringing, and no one knew of the heartache I was in because of the way my son was being treated. It was just an ongoing heartache for me at that point. And I took that letter and read it and couldn't believe it. To make a long story short, and to keep this within our time range, I have to tell you, God opened up doors, and we went to Japan. A Japanese man bought our home. It was just phenomenal to me. He had never been to Japan, but he knocked on my door and wanted to know if we wanted to sell our home. We hadn't even seen the realtor or signed anything with the realtor yet, and yet my house sold. I gave away everything I owned to my kids. I mean, every dish, every spoon, every whatever, and gave all our stuff. They came up with trucks and got it, brought it back down here. And I tell you what, we took off for Japan for the magnificent time of our life. Now, what I want to get through to you is, in the middle of all these happenings, there is no place that I saw the grace of God. And I wonder how many precious opportunities our God has given us that we don't realize they're from God and His glorious grace that comes in rhythms. Rhythms. When I first read that verse out of the Message Bible, I want to tell you people, I cried for 3 days, tears of thanksgiving, because all at once I began to look back and see God had brought rhythm to bring me out of the occult. God had brought rhythm to bring me to a place that I had a grandmother that would teach me about the Lord. God got a place to give me a husband that loved God and loved me and loved His kids, and precious, precious man of God. And God had brought His rhythm, had brought His rhythm, had brought His rhythm through ever, even to the point of my husband driving up at the same time the taxi drove up. It was all part of God's rhythm of grace. And little did I know that all of this that I didn't want to do was going to open up the very doors that we had dreamed of since 1960. And we got to go to Japan and work with our first base we were that we lived by was the Marine Air Corps base in Iwakuni, Japan. And I tell you what, precious people, we saw hundreds of those young Marines give their lives to the Lord. And one day I was walking here in Arcadia, and I walked past a newspaper stand on the street, and the USA newspaper was there, and there was a picture that covered the half of the front page, and it was a Marine baptizing other Marines, and the line lined up to be baptized was so long in the picture, you couldn't see the end of it. They were over there in Iraq, and this man had brought these people to the Lord, and he built a baptistry and lined it with something that kept the water from draining out, filled it, and was baptizing all these Marines. And I looked at that picture, and I go, God, what an awesome God you are, right in the middle of the street. That was the young man that was the one that caused us the most trouble of all while we were in Japan. He had fought God with every fiber of his being. And I'll close this story telling you one more moment of grace that concerns that young man. His name is George, and he's one step short of being a general today. And he started out as an 18-year-old, mad at the world, who had grown up in the streets, in the gangs of Philadelphia. He met God in a powerful way. One night, we had five of our young men that wanted to preach, and we had advised them to go over and talk to them at the base and find out if they'd give them a room and set it all up, but do it with all the right information that they needed. So they set this night up, and they were going to preach and do worship, and they asked Pop and I if we'd come, and we said, sure, we'll be there. So we were there, and we were sitting in the back, and these precious kids just took over. It was beautiful. And at the end, they offered prayer. So many people came up that they called Pop and I up to help pray. So I was standing in line going to the break through the line to get to where I wanted to start with my prayer group. And there was this young man standing there. And we had heard about George, but we had not met George at this point, just heard about him. So I walk up to this young man, and I have my hand up like this, and I go to just lay my hand on his chest, and I won't tell you, the power of God hit him and just knocked him out on the floor. Well, we didn't want to leave him there. He was slain in the spirit, and we knew that the other people would think he was drunk, and he was drunk in the Holy Spirit. And so we stayed with him. He woke up, came to about 2 o'clock in the morning, 3 o'clock, between 2 and 3 o'clock in the morning, and we were sitting there talking to him, and I said, he introduced himself as Gordy, because that was his last name, and that's what's on his pocket. He says, my name's Gordy. And I said, George, did you ever come to meet Jesus tonight? And he goes, no, ma'am. I was standing in line to get a Coke. And I tell you, God transformed that young man. And he's still transformed today. And that's another one of those things, those moments of grace where we don't always realize it's that grace of God coming in rhythms in our life. And I tell you, I want to challenge you as I close today. I want to challenge you. Begin to ask God to give revelation to you, to understand those moments of grace. Because they're beautiful. They're awesome. They teach us what we sang today. They teach us the beauty of God. And I had a phone call this past month and a half ago, I think it was, when we were going through the happenings with Joseph and the Ku Klux Klan were burning crosses on our front yard. The third time they came, my son had gotten on the basketball team, and believe me, he was a star basketball player, and they had just won the championship. These men came with all the threats in the world, threats to kill Joseph, threats to kill me, and all at once, I just felt God give me exactly what to say. And I said, if I were to pull off every one of your hoods, I am sure that most of you are very happy that my son is playing basketball for your team. And they turned around and walked away, and they never came back. That was grace. Beautiful grace. And I got a letter, and how he ever got my address here, I don't know, but he must have run into one of my grandsons that live up there and got it. But he was one of those men that came with his hood on. And he shared his story about how God had come and touched him, and how God had healed him of his rage against other races, and God had begun to show him how beautiful all of God's creation was, and that he'd given his life to the Lord, and so had his entire family. I have to tell you, when they came to my house, it did not look like grace. But it was, because now I have another part of the story that shows us it was the grace of God. So I want to just say to you, take the time on a daily basis to ask God to bring revelation to you as the day goes on, where he touches you in that rhythm of grace. And may I read that verse to you one more time, because it's awesome. Are you tired? We are, aren't we? Are we worn out? Burned out on religion? It's Jesus talking. He says, come to me. Get away with me, and you will recover your life. What a promise. What a promise. It's not that you might recover your life, it's that you will recover your life. I'll show you how to take a real rest. I am for that. How about the rest of you? I am ready to learn the real rest of God. Walk with me. Jesus said, come on, walk with me. Work with me. Watch how I do it. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace. I won't lay down anything heavy or ill-fitting on you. That is another promise. God is not going to give us more than we can take. Isn't that awesome? Keep company with me, and you will learn to live freely and lightly. Amen. I'm ready to learn to live freely and lightly. How about you? Amen. It's an awesome thing to be together like we are today. And God come and bring his transforming power in our midst. That we will be women that know the grace of God when it comes, that receive it, but also that we will pour out the grace of God as well to others. Amen. Let's pray. God, I thank you for each precious woman here. I thank you for the grace that only you can give. And God, I pray we become more alive and more willing to see the beautiful moments that you're making ready for us, and that we will truly know that you promise us if we choose your path, you will direct our steps. And God, we thank you for that. We thank you, we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
Thank you, Jenny. All right, you ready to hear this? Just a minute of it. Let's see if I can make it work. You ready? That's impressive. That's impressive. You know, I don't know. I remember. I don't know if any of us expect enough when we open our Bibles. I don't know if you expect to come in today and this be one of those days that everything shifts. You know, I remember being in third grade, and math, even from that age, was not my strength. And I remember one day that, for some reason, the teacher had probably said it 1,000 times. She drew like three apples three times, and the light bulb just went on. Nine, of course. I'm sure I was the last person in the class to get it. Our expectations in our relationship to Jesus, and certainly in our relationship to the other people we love, can set us up for real challenge. And Matthew wants us to see a portrait of Jesus, and in some ways, a portrait of ourselves. Now, let's look at chapter 11 first. When Jesus finished teaching the 12 disciples, he just went on from there to preach, to teach in their cities. And when John heard in prison about the things that Christ was doing, he sent word by his disciples to Jesus asking, "Are you the one who is to come, or should we look for another?" Now, there are a lot of scholars down through the ages who have been determined that John the Baptist had zero doubt and he really just needed his disciples not to doubt. And I think we are fooling ourselves if we deify John beyond. John, in chapter 3, has been seeing the one who is to come, the Messiah, as one who will judge with fire, who will straighten things out. I don't think John had necessarily political aspirations, as did some of the people of God, but he certainly had expectations about cleaning house. I mean, revival to the max, right? And then he has this crazy experience with Jesus in the baptism. He certainly knows, probably the scholars do, whether he heard God's voice, but Jesus certainly heard it. But what he did see was the dove, right? And he tells, I had you read in the other gospel, where he says, my understanding was the one on whom the dove, you know, God had given him a sign to confirm. He'd had the story of Mary and Elizabeth. He had no reason to doubt, and he was sure, except that now, in spite of all of these things happening, John is in prison and Herod is still on the throne. And things are not looking at all the way that John expected. Jesus is out in the backwater in sort of rural Oregon, helping people and healing people and all that. But like, when's it going to start? I will never forget. I when I was visiting churches a few years ago, I went to a small house church and the people were sharing with me that they had been leading this for 3 years now and da 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 da, and I was so excited for them. It was just a powerful presence of the Spirit in this home church. And I met with them later, and the woman gave me a phone number. The wife gave me a phone number. She said, "Would you call my mom? Because she keeps asking when we're going to launch. When we're going to have a building and when we're going to really launch this thing, and it's going to be big." And she said, "I think we've launched, Mom. This is it." And I think of her when I think of John the Baptist, what the expectation was, what his understanding was. And John the Baptist was faithful. John the Baptist is not somebody who was at odds with Jesus, but it's not looking like he had imagined. You know, the Old Testament is so full of prophecy and poetry, and we like to fill in the blanks, and so did the people of that day. And so, yes, the goal would be reached, and Jesus will strengthen him. But in the meantime, it's not looking quite like rhythms of grace to John. And Jesus becomes, I want you to see the portrait that I think Matthew wants us to see of Jesus here, which is, yes, he is the promised Messiah. And yes, when the rhythms of grace are hard to understand, Jesus strengthens. John doesn't ask for a sign. John asks a point-blank question. Are you the one? Because for John, if Jesus is the Messiah, that's enough. That's enough. But what does Jesus say to the disciples? Go back and report to John what you hear and see. We all come to Jesus by his word and his actions, by the way in which he builds our testimony and the testimony of those in the family that he, nuclear family that he gives us in community. But he says, those who were blind are able to see. He begins to pull from three passages in Isaiah that were precious to John and likely very unique to John's own spiritual life. Those who are crippled are walking. People with skin diseases are cleansed. Those who were deaf now hear. Those who were dead are raised up. The poor have good news proclaimed to them. And then Jesus says the most important words of all. And I don't particularly like the Common English Bible, but maybe in your groups you can read that verse out of different versions in 6. Happy are those who don't stumble and fall on account of me. I liked somebody who said, and God bless you, John, if you don't throw the whole thing over because it doesn't look like you thought it would. I love that. That is Jesus strengthening them. You know, John and his disciples, because his disciples keep coming with these questions. Hey, we have to fast. How come they don't fast? Hey, we have to do this. How come your guys aren't doing this? They have a lot of questions because Jesus isn't looking at all like what they expected. Yeah. They seem to be saying, you know, you're out there bringing hope, but the Pharisees still control the popular religious life. The Sadducees still control the temple. The theological systems are just humming along, even though we all know they're broken, and you're not doing anything about this. You know, Capernaum, who Jesus will rebuke later in this chapter, had a motto, I'm told. This was so interesting. Lifted out of Isaiah 14, 13, their town motto was lifted to heaven. And the scholars believe that was because of the work that Jesus was doing in their area, sort of like in God we trust, right? Like that was like their motto. And they were really happy to have Jesus there and have all the excitement and the news and the stories and the healings and all those things. But it wasn't touching them. It wasn't changing them. It was a thing. It was the story of the day. It was the news. But it wasn't. They weren't allowing it to transform them. Saints doubt. That's the message of here. Saints have doubt, and faith is not sight. We are called to live by faith, not by sight. So there are always going to be things we cannot understand. Doubt taken to Jesus is met with tender encouragement, very personal, tender encouragement. Now, let's bring it down to us. We are not prophets. We are not, thankfully, eating locusts yet. Although, with the supply chain, who knows what could happen next. But we are not. We are not John the Baptist, but we are all of enough of an age, at least most of us, that we've hit the wall. When we moved here, we had lost Bill's brother to cancer. We had Young, who was in, Betty's son, in training to become a minister. One of our best friends had been gone for a walk and been abducted, raped, and murdered. Her husband was arrested initially. He had nothing to do with it. He was released. When we came here, I said, I don't know, but I don't understand. Are you, God, really the one? There's a lot more to that story. But the bottom line is I went to a baby shower. We were going to only be here for a year. I went to a baby shower at my neighbor's house, and her sister was a leader in Bible study fellowship, and I was not interested. And she was really wanting me to come. And she took care of the children, and at the time, if you had children under 2, you couldn't go to BSF. And I was like, that's my out. Got one that is too young. And so one day, she kept inviting me, and I was like, why did I give her my number? You know, we're only here for a year. I'm just trying to get through this year. We're moving. We're not, this is temporary. And one day she showed up at my house at like 7:30 in the morning, and she said, get dressed. I got somebody to cover my class. You're going today. I'll keep Will. What are you going to say? Okay. She did. I went, ended up teaching that class for a number of years. That, for me and everyone, it was such a personal tenderness from Jesus to say, oh, yeah, I'm the one. And your ideas about me, they need to go. I think it's Walter Brueggemann who says, the people of God have a failed imagination. We do not have a big enough imagination for the creativity of God, who begins and ends his book with utter new creations, and in the middle talks about how he'll make the same of us. And so I don't know what your questions are, and I don't think it's a once and settled thing. I think we hit roadblocks in life that send us right back to saying, are you the one? I think the key is to take it to Jesus and to wait for those rhythms of grace to bring answer a hundredfold over what we would have necessarily needed. I also think as people, women of a certain age, we need to be tenderhearted toward those who are stuck there longer than we remember being stuck there with questions. A popular writer wrote this week. Sorry, I've lost it now. She said, I was in my 20s when the towers fell in New York. I was concerned about the Iraq War and the SARS outbreak, and then I went into a straight free fall of faith until about 2006. It wasn't just the geopolitical social justice stuff. It was the responses of other believers to those issues. I remember actually being in a church and hearing a pastor say, we should kill all the women and children of those terrorists and go Old Testament on them because America needs to be protected. And then she put in parentheses, she was a pastor's wife at the time. It wasn't her husband. You cannot make this up. Then on top of that, Brian and I were experiencing our own losses through miscarriage and ministry, which had me questioning what I believed about prayer and miracles and signs and wonders and women's worth and voices and calling and, and community. I wasn't as smart as her. I just got stuck on the first one. Scripture and even God altogether. The biggest reason I found myself in the wilderness was because of grief. I was grieving my own losses, but in many ways, the church at the time broke my heart, and I didn't know what to do with my questions and doubts. I want us to be tender, like Jesus, to the people who are there a little longer or under a little more pressure than we might have been, and just pray for them. Hang on to them. Jesus goes on after praising John. You know, I can't even imagine what the crowd must have thought as Jesus talked about this man that he loved, his cousin, whom would in a short time be beheaded by a cruel and ridiculous set of circumstances. He says he is the Elijah. I love that Jesus not only tells John who he is, he tells the world who John was. When Jesus says, if you will carry my name, I will carry yours. Jesus does that there. And then Jesus gets a little human. A little more human, I should say. He's fully human. He's fully divine. I can't. You know what I'm trying to say. Don't email me, please, about that. You know what I mean. To what will I compare this generation? He says it's like a child sitting in the marketplace calling out to others. We played the flute for you, and you didn't dance. That would have referred to a wedding, celebratory things. Or we sang a funeral song, and you didn't mourn. A funeral. John had come preaching funeral, fire. Jesus had come celebrating the kingdom. And they didn't like either one of those things. Because, as Ginny said, our default is to say, what about me? What about my issue? If you're all loving and all knowing and all powerful, what about me? And I want us to be careful not to be too hard on the Pharisees and the Sadducees, the people of God at the time who were deeply oppressed. They were suffering injustice and had been for a number of years. So to want freedom from that is something I think we can all relate to. But the problem was they wanted what they wanted more than they wanted what God had in mind, these rhythms of grace that would go so much further than they could ever imagine. So when the rhythms of grace are hard to understand, Jesus strengthens. When the rhythms of grace are hard to hear, and the rhythms of life are hard to bear, Jesus saves. We've covered that well with Jenny at the end of chapter 11. Jesus confronts the people of God and says, "Wake up. Revival is here. Wake up. Wake up. This is the moment. This is it. Instead of looking at your life as a series of events thrust on you or manipulated by you or crafted and curated by you, what if every single event, whether it's a car alarm or something you've made more beautiful, is strung together in a rhythm of grace that goes all the way to eternity that you cannot even yet see or imagine?" Jesus, in the rest of chapter 11, has this sort of drumbeat of conviction for the people of God, but also this harmony of lullaby for the people who are exhausted, for the crowds who say, "We don't understand, but we know there's something here. The temple doesn't want us. I'm ostracized from this or that." And Jesus says, "Just come on. Just come on." I have a friend I remember saying to me, a Korean-American woman who'd come here as an immigrant to go to Fuller, and she said, "I just always feel, Kelly, like there's not enough chairs, like there won't be a chair at the table for me." And I said, "And if there's not, there's the lap of Jesus." And I think that's what Matthew is pointing to here. If you feel like they've all taken the chairs and you're not invited, guess where you're invited? Right into his embrace. Right there. So while Jesus perfectly in chapter 11 runs this beautiful truth of grace and law, of waking up to the privilege that is ours in the church, and recognizing also the times we just need to be embraced. It's both. Where the rhythms of grace meet strongholds in chapter 13, whether it's healing or demonic issues that the people have, whether it's Jesus and the brothers saying, "Jesus has gone overboard, let's go get him, let's go get him. He's going to get us all in trouble, he's saying too much." Certainly, when Matthew tells us in chapter 12, verse 14, the Pharisees went out and met in order to find a way to destroy Jesus. The ante has been upped. And what has he done? He's healed people. I think it's so fascinating that they keep asking him for a sign. When John didn't ask for a sign, he said, look around you. Look, people are being healed. These things are happening. The Pharisees had that very same sign, but they wouldn't accept it. And so I have no doubt that Jesus' family heard about this plot to kill him and decide to come rescue him from that, a little like Peter in the garden, a little like we can do when we try to defend Jesus rather than love and pray for people. We can sometimes be in a place of not allowing Jesus to speak and do for himself in the very purposeful way that he wants to. In all of chapter 12, essentially, Jesus is putting the three things that they held dearest, the Sabbath, the law, and the temple, in their proper place. All of the Old Testament is consummated in Jesus. But like us, we want to hold on to symbols sometimes more than we want to hold on to truth. Jesus essentially says, it's so fascinating to me that he says at the end of chapter 11, come to me, I'll give you rest. And the very next thing is a debate about what rest really means. You're eating on the Sabbath, you're working on the Sabbath. I've been in buildings where you can't press the button in an elevator. If you go to Cedar Sinai Hospital on the Sabbath, their Sabbath, and you get in the elevator, you will stop on every floor, because if you're Orthodox, you don't press the button, so you just wait till you get to your floor. I understand that to be a reverence. I understand that to be a way of reverencing God on the Sabbath, that I'm not making fun of that. But what I am saying is that Jesus says, I'm the one who gives rest. I'm the one the Sabbath pointed. The Sabbath was a day to say, we've done enough. We'll trust God for today. And Jesus says, now you can trust me for every day. Every day. And that was hard for them to hear. Jesus is the great rest giver and restorer. I love that he doesn't get bitter and fussing and caught up in the argument. He just goes on and keeps healing people. He stays focused on what he's doing. And finally, he begins at the end of chapter 12, before it even gets to his family, Matthew points a portrait of Jesus that says what he really, really longs for is relationship. All of the symbols, all of the things we do for him or don't do because we want to honor him, those are lovely. But what he really, really, really wants is relationship. The Holy Spirit speaks to people. And to quench him, I know some people may be struggling with verses 31 and 32. Therefore, I tell you, the people will be forgiven for every sin and insult to God, but insulting the Holy Spirit won't be forgiven. Whoever speaks a word against the human one will be forgiven, but whoever speaks against the Holy Spirit won't be forgiven. Those are hard words, and I can provide you with wonderful commentary on it, but the bottom line is, if you're worried about that, you probably don't need to worry about that. The Holy Spirit's work in so far has been to conceive Jesus, to elevate Jesus, to empower Jesus at the baptism, to attend to Jesus. The Holy Spirit is involved in every aspect of Jesus' life as he is in ours. Jesus is saying, receive that. Receive that. A refusal, an embittered, I will not, is putting us in a dangerous place. But God's relentless rhythms of grace and mercy keep coming in the form of the Spirit speaking to us. Trees and fruits. In other words, to dwell with me is to be made useful, to be made... my favorite thing about this illustration Jesus commonly uses is that the tree itself doesn't eat the fruit. If we are filled with God's Spirit, we are able to provide nourishment to others. That's God's purpose and plan. He says, signs. He talks about Jonah. I love that story. But Jonah was just a lost case. He was a head case. I mean, he was a mess. He hated everybody who wasn't just like him. And God says, you know, Jonah went. His little, what is it, three words or five words sermon, and the whole city repents. Jesus is saying to them, it isn't going to be signs. It's my word and my works. And I think Jesus, there are many people there, we have to remember, like Nicodemus, who are wondering, who are part of that Pharisee and Sadducee group, but they're wondering. They may not be the ones with the loudest voice or the most power in the group, but Jesus keeps offering again and again and again, every sign needful to show them that he is indeed the Messiah. Jesus wants relationship not only with us, but through us to others. He goes on to talk about that story of the sort of the parable, really, about the empty house and the demons, and it's a parable, essentially. Not a Halloween story, but a definite parable about where he's saying, you know, you're designed to be filled with something. It'll either be me or it'll be something awful. Choose well. I want to fill you. And then this beautiful picture of, I have no idea why Jesus' mother and brothers were there. The scholars assume what I alluded to earlier, that maybe they were trying to kind of settle things down a little out of love for him. We have no indication whether they believed him at this point or not. But either way, our human nature as a parent, as a friend, is to protect, right? Let's go have something to drink, Jesus, and calm down a little. But he makes clear for them and all of us that doing the will of the Father makes him our brother and God our Father. When the rhythms of grace draw us in, Jesus secures us, leaning on those everlasting arms. I don't know how you approach doubt in your own life, whether you shame it away or feel guilty about it or throw it out for all the world to see. I don't think it much matters as long as it's taken to Jesus. And when it is, it will be met, will be strengthened. The alarm may continue to sound, but there'll be the music of the rhythms of grace overpowering it and one day absorbing it all. Father, thank you for this reminder. Lord, how little we can see. How little we can see in our own lives, much less the lives, the eternal perspective. And so, Father, forgive us our sin. As we forgive and pray for those around us, lead us not into temptation, but Lord, when we find ourselves there, deliver us from it. May we just rest and lean into those rivers of grace till they carry us home. We ask this in your name, amen. I know I've taken too much time. I want to share one last thing with you. I really feel like a very close friend of mine was going to move to Glendora. She lived in La Cañada, and her next door neighbor, young couple, for about 4 years had said, when you sell your house, we want to buy it. They said, okay, work it out. My friend is a realtor. She's not working now, but okay, we'll just do it. They set a price. Everything was set. Until about 3 months before they decided to, where they were planning to move, at which point they find out that that deal is off, and in fact, they have bought the other neighbor's house. Now, this had been like a conversation over a decade, and over the last 3 years, an intense conversation. It was out of the blue, and they didn't find out from them. They found out from the people whose house they bought. And my friend was shocked. Her husband was really upset. They had a plan. They had agreed on a price. Everything had been done. And she said, one of the things I love most about my husband is his ability to forgive. And sure enough, about a week later, he went over and talked to the neighbor, and he said to him, I heard you bought Bruce's house, and I'm really happy for you. That must have been the best decision for your family. the young man, different culture, different. He was nervous, awkward. He takes him on a tour of the house. Now, they were friends too, but, you know, just one of those awkward things. And Nancy said she watched her husband just delight in everything he said. Well, of course, you know, it's not that hard to sell a house a year ago, so they sold their house to someone else. They moved to Glendora. Within that year, they got a call from him, and he said, "My wife's at Huntington, and she's dying, 40 years old." And he said, one of the last things she said to me was, "Now you make sure you raise our daughter as a Christian. Not like those church people, some of them we know, but like, and she said the name of my friend and her husband, like them." And Nancy, my friend, said to me, in that moment, it became abundantly clear that God had given the grace to forgive. They were able to minister to that family. They're continuing to do that. They had not told anyone that she had cancer. She'd actually been battling it for 7 years. Not a word to anybody. But she had watched them over the years, and this final sort of test had proved that they trusted God more than their plan to sell the house, that they were not bitter, that they weren't difficult. The rhythm of God's grace was flowing in ways that no one could imagine. And I think that's why Jesus keeps saying to us, love me, love your neighbor. You have no idea what adventure we're on together. All right, enjoy your discussion time.